Hello, and welcome to our Women's Walk with Christ blog, Speaking Life. My name is Margaret Hilton, and this is my co-host, Kim Turner.
Hello, and welcome, sisters, and happy May to all of you. We are already in the fifth month of 2021. Unreal.
It is May.
It's May, and we've been gone for a couple of weeks, so we're excited to be doing our show again and getting to know a new sister that we'll bring on here in just a minute. And we hope that you all just had a wonderful Mother's Day yesterday and that you were able to share it and spend it with your family. So I'll let Margaret introduce our guest.
Yes, our special guest today is Miss Dee Beiter, and she lives in Pennsylvania. And I believe she did her weekend in 2015, and she is our coordinator for our at-home prayer team. And so if you've ever been on the at-home prayer team during a weekend, then she is the one that sends out the emails and kind of helps guide you along to pray during the weekend. And let's see, here she comes. Miss Dee, welcome.
There she is. Hello, Dee.
Hey. How are you?
I miss you all. See your beautiful faces.
Look at your hair. It's so long.
It's so curly.
It's so great. I was getting to that too. It looks great.
Well, thank you. And no, it's not a perm.
No.
It's just all natural.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh, you're kidding.
No, all the curls are there are mine. Thank you, Mother.
I love it. I think it looks great.
Well, thank you.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for joining us and being on the show. And if you could start by sharing your mission statement and when you went on your weekend.
My mission statement is, as a strong and resilient woman walking with Christ in intentional faith, I co-create a world of forgiveness, peace, and hope, using my gifts of unconditional love, compassion, and a tender heart to encourage others to seek refuge and reconciliation in the Holy Spirit. And my weekend was June 2015 at Malvern.
Wow. That's what I thought, that you went in 2015. Was that one of our first weekends in Pennsylvania?
Think so.
Okay.
I think so, yes.
Wow. Awesome. Well, so our next question is then, how long did it take you to write your mission statement?
I want to say I wrote my original mission statement at the weekend, and I liked it, but it just wasn't quite right. It didn't completely resonate with me. I knew that there was a piece missing and I wasn't quite sure what it was until after staffing a weekend at Malvern. And Lucy Gerken was my spirit circle leader on my original weekend. And I remember looking at her at that weekend and saying to her, Lucy, I will be back to staff with you. Not only have I been back to staff with Lucy, I have roomed with Lucy.
Oh, nice.
Oh, it's come full circle. But there was just something missing. And after staffing a weekend in Malvern, two of my beautiful Pennsylvania sisters came up to me and said, you know, watching you when we say goodbye is just... It's just something. She said, you just ooze love. She said, you have such a tender heart and you just ooze love. And she's like, I always say that when we say goodbye, I park a box of Kleenex at my feet because I know I'm going to go through it. My family says I cry at supermarket openings and I cry at everything. I am just, it's just when something touches me deeply, I cry. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, that's what's missing. That's what's missing. And that's when that piece went into my mission statement. And I'm thinking, okay. And then a couple of years ago, I got a chance to be a nurturing wise woman at weekend. And I remember taking another sister to the airport on Monday and we were talking about the weekend. And she said, Dee, what's your mission statement? And I told her, and she said, you lived your mission statement this weekend. Mm-hmm. Wow. So, and of course I cried with that as well.
Of course.
I say.
Hey, it's a good thing, I think.
I think that's so. Highest compliment you can receive when someone hears your mission and says you lived exactly that, you know, like that's awesome.
And small world, I think all three of us, our spirit circle leader was Lucy Gerken on our first weekend.
Yeah,
yep. Us too. Cool. Different weekends, all three of us for different weekends, but she was our spirit circle leader on all three.
Wow.
Crazy.
That's quite a legacy.
It yes. is. And for me, she's always been my nurturing wise woman every time I've given a testimony. Every time. She's just the perfect person that God put in my life that I didn't know I needed.
Isn't that true?
Yeah.
Isn't that so true?
She is. She's a beautiful lady.
She is. She is.
So our next question for you, which leads in what you're talking about very well, is about the Enneagram. And Kim, guess what number she is?
I'm not even going to say. Just not.
Dee is an Enneagram 2. We love having Enneagram 2s on our show, Dee.
Cool. No.
Everybody's been a 2.
Surprise, surprise.
Right. There's like a theme.
2 is the best number, so.
I would agree, and Margaret, because I know you're a 2, so yeah. I would agree wholeheartedly.
I was shocked. I'm like, really? Another 2?
Just embrace it.
Maybe I'm secretly a 2.
No, you're a 9.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
Oh, your nineness.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
So what you were talking about with, you know, your emotions and crying, you know, at the, you know, at the supermarket opening, or, you know, just being able to feel all the feels. I think that's a quality of it too, because I am also a crier. Sometimes I hate it because like when I get mad, I cry and I'm not sad. It's just what comes out. So talk to us about your Enneagram and how you use it, or why you like it, or what you don't like about it. Just talk to us about your Enneagram number.
I think it's very, speaks to who I am. I discovered not too long ago, and it just kind of made all things fall into place, that I am something that they call an HSP, highly sensitive person. Oh yeah. We're emotions on the sleeve, you know, introvert, believe it or not, introvert. And it just, yeah. Okay. I feel things more deeply. You know, if I hear a beautiful music, in my house growing up, we used to say Mozart wasn't good Mozart unless mama cried. So I come by it naturally. It's just, if something touches my heart deeply, I guarantee you, I'm going to be toast.
Yeah.
So I just have a question about that, because I know a little bit about you and your work life. How did that play out for you as a 2 being a police officer?
It actually stood me in very good stead as a police officer, believe it or not, because people used to tease me and tell me that I changed personalities when I put the uniform on. I walked differently. I talked differently. I carried myself differently. And I think a lot of it is you learn as a police officer, you learn to not necessarily shut your emotions out, but to not let your emotions interfere with your job. Because if you become too emotionally involved, you cannot be a good advocate for victims. I did a lot as the only female officer in my department. I did a lot of child abuse. I did a lot of sexual assault cases. And the only way that you can successfully advocate for a victim in those hideous circumstances is to turn off the emotional part of your brain and be the best advocate that you can for that victim. Cross your T's, dot your I's, put a period at the end of your sentence, and just you can't fall apart, because if you fall apart, it doesn't instill any kind of confidence in them that you're going to be able to present their case and get them the justice that they need.
Yeah. That's awesome. How were you able, because as a two, I'm very conflict averse. Would you consider yourself conflict averse? And if so, how did you be able to separate that and deal with conflict head on in your job if it's so against your personality?
Again, it was a personality change when I put the uniform on. Okay. This is what my job is. This is what my job entails. You shut the emotions out because you can't let them interfere, because in being a female in a predominantly male profession, to this day, it's still predominantly male. Being a female in a predominantly male situation, when you first start out, you are on an unknown quantity in two factors. You're a rookie and you're a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to prove yourself. And I can honestly tell you, although I kind of laugh about it now, I can honestly tell you that one of my greatest compliments was being accepted. Was being accepted. And I worked in a very small department, and there was one officer on at a time. So when anything hot and heavy happened, people would roll in. But they learned that I didn't call for backup for everything. I didn't. But if I called for backup, they came in from the woodwork. You know, I would have them coming from everywhere, because they knew that if I called for backup, I really needed it. It wasn't, this delicate little woman who can't handle things. It's like, holy crud, if she's calling for backup, you know, let's do a feet don't fail me now, because she really does need help. She's not just wussing out. She really needs help.
Wow.
I so honor that you were able to be respected in a profession full of men, and that you held your ground. And I guess what I'm hearing you say is kind of like when we say, you know, put on your armor, put up your shield. When a woman is doing her work, don't let it like seep into you. Just kind of when you put on your uniform, you put on a shield.
Exactly. And you cannot, when we're working with a woman doing her work, you can't, you know, can you work with her, and can you listen to what she says without being, if you will, sucked into the vortex and sucked into emotions and what's going on, because you can't help her.
Mm-hmm.
You can't work with her, because we're walking with women as they heal and transform in Christ. Mm-hmm. And you can't walk with that woman effectively if you are so emotionally involved.
Mm-hmm.
You just can't do it. You're doing her a disservice, and you're doing yourself a disservice.
Yeah. It's something as a two, I have to check myself. Like when I am asked to facilitate, like, can I put up my shield and separate myself from this woman's emotions to, like you said, be able to help her as best as I can, to hear the Holy Spirit and not let myself get in the way. So
that brings me to, if you don't mind my doing this, but one of the questions that I that really got to me was, what is the most impactful thing a wise woman has told you?
Yeah.
And the most impactful thing a wise woman has told me is the first time I was ever privileged to be a wise woman, I was an absolute, complete, total, and utter mess before we got there. It's like I was a total bundle of nerves, thinking, am I gonna be able to do this? Because to me, that's such an important, and it's such a privilege to be able to do that. And I'm thinking, am I gonna be able to do this? Am I gonna be able to do this effectively? And it was actually the first time I did it, I was in Colorado.
Oh,
and Susie Schnurbusch, who I love to the moon and back again, gave me the most beautiful piece of advice. And I treasure it to this day. And I stand by it. I think it's the most beautiful thing that I'd ever heard. And she said, you know what I do before I sit as a wise woman? I ask the Holy Spirit to help me get out of my own way and listen to what he has to say. And I took that to heart. And every time I'm privileged to be a wise woman, I sit and I close my eyes and I center myself and I say, Holy Spirit, just give me the grace and the wisdom to be able to get the heck out of my own way and let your words come out. Mm-hmm. And I can't, half the time, I can't tell you what I've said. And I can't tell you sometimes why I say what I say, because I don't know. I have no clue. I don't know why I say what I say.
Yeah.
We do. It's the Holy Spirit.
Because it's, you know, people have said to me, I asked a woman one question one time, and she looked at me, talk about deer in the headlights look, just, how did you know that? You know,
I didn't.
I didn't. The Holy Spirit, if the Holy Spirit had whispered it to me, I wouldn't have known to ask the question.
Right. And it's one thing to listen, but then it's also to trust it and say it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I've noticed. And I've been around you a couple of times in staff, and you hear it and you say it. You trust what he's saying to you. And I think that that's beautiful, you know, because a lot of times people are like, can't be talking to me. Is he talking to me?
I didn't hear that. There's no way I heard
that.
You
know that. You say what he's saying. And I think that that's beautiful. And that's why you've been called to that wise woman role and nurturing wise woman, because you listen and you speak. And I think that's awesome.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
I'm sure there'll be one lady that I'll answer that question and say, this wise woman Dee told me. It's coming. I know.
I will be humbled. Yeah. I will be absolutely humbled.
It is, right?
By that.
Well, and when those moments happen, we call them the Holy Spirit goosebump moments. There's no other way to explain it.
John Monroe would call them Holy Spirit shells.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Same thing.
It's absolutely beautiful to see, right? And you're just like, that's amazing. You know, I'm one of those people that'll be like, did I hear that? What? I don't think he's talking to me.
Oh, he blows me out of my socks all the time. All the time. One of the things that I have also been privileged to do is be part of the team that calls women mm-hmm. for the weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And I have no idea why I make the pairings that I do. But a lot of the conversations, it's just, you know, it's like, where did that come from? And I have a saying on the on a wall in my office that reads, coincidence is a small miracle in which God chooses to remain anonymous. And I just love that. And I'm thinking, I'm getting chills just thinking about it. And I'm thinking, it is no coincidence that I am making the calls that I do. And I have made some amazing connections with women because of the calls that I have made. And it's just, it's something that I really enjoy.
And that's such an important part of our ministry, because before a woman comes on a weekend, she sometimes has questions or she's nervous. And we're just so blessed that you love to do it and that you've committed to doing it and that you do such a good job. When I do registration, you know, you email me and say, okay, these are the women I connected with and these are the women I still need to connect with. You're very diligent about it. And we're just so blessed that you take that on every weekend.
Thank you. And it's amazing for an introvert that I love doing it.
Right. So you're kind of going against what you said before. But hey, he's calling you in to do something different, right?
He's calling me into doing something that, you know, I love the connections that I make, the heart connections. And I think that's, again, that's part of the tender heart portion of my mission statement. It's something I love doing. I love connecting with the women.
Are you looking for any new women on your team for the calling team?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, yes, please. So absolutely. Even though we are, we're reducing the number of missioners. I have a number of women on my team, but again, I am respectful of family commitments, mm-hmm. Or things going on in people's worlds. And when people are up to here with things, and, you know, if you want to sit out, you know, because you're up to here, I get that. I honestly get that. But would I love to have more women on the team? Absolutely. Absolutely. People who have a heart for the ministry and reaching out and making, having a heart for hospitality and welcome.
What's the best way for somebody to get in contact with you to join your team?
Email me.
And what is your email?
Oh, you're going to love this one. It's dfuzz, D-E-E-F as in Frank, U-Z-Z-Z, three Z's on fuzz, at yahoo.com.
Okay.
And yes, Amen. That is a play on my name and my former profession.
Now, for all of you who know, Christy will put that at the bottom, I'm sure, if you didn't hear Dee say it. So it'll be at the bottom. So if you have that calling and you want to be able to connect with women, be on the call.
I'd love to have you.
Yeah, because you're definitely the first voice that they get to hear as a representative mm-hmm. of Women's Walk. And it's a blessing. And a lot of women I've heard say that it starts from that moment when they get that phone call, you know, their process and how they feel about the ministry. And so your team does a fantastic job. It's a blessing to us all.
Thank you. And I have phenomenal women on the team, absolutely phenomenal women on the team with huge hearts and welcoming spirits.
I remember my first call. It's a very important part of the ministry. So,
oh, it absolutely is.
Yeah. Great.
And a lot of times you make connections with the woman who called you.
Mm-hmm.
Stacy Hazleton called me.
Yeah.
And I have a very close connection with Stacy.
Because it's your first contact. You. Like, that's awesome. Yep.
Well, okay, so our next question for you is, how has God changed your life through Women's Walk with Christ?
Wow. Actually, both Marked Men and Women's Walk have changed my life immensely. Mm-hmm. David and I dated for 3.5 years, and I didn't think the man was ever going to get off the fence. Seriously, didn't think the man was ever going to get off the fence. And a dear friend of ours convinced him to go to Marked Men. And I will tell you that 2 weeks before Marked Men, we had the grandmother, actually probably the great grandmother of all fights. I mean, it was a doozy. And he said, that's it. You know, this relationship was over. We're done. We managed to patch things up. He went to Marked Men. He comes home and I said, well, how was the weekend? And he said, it was really good, but we need to talk. And I'm thinking, not one of those, we need to talk, you know, where you see the handwriting on the wall and your life flashes before you. No, but we need to talk. Okay. There's a serious discussion we really need to have. I said, okay, fine. And so he puttered around and did some things. And then he said, okay, we need to talk. And I said, okay, fine, babe, what's on your mind? And he said, well, I wasn't ready before, but I am now. And as a marked man for Christ, some things have to change. I'm getting chills just thinking about it. He looks me square in the face and says, will you marry me? Talk about almost fall off the chair, girlfriend. I was like, because I looked at him and I seriously said to him, are you serious?
No.
And he said, yes, will you marry me? And of course, what did I do?
You cried.
What did I do?
I think you might have cried.
Of course I did. Of course I did. And because that had made such a huge impact on his life, as a matter of fact, it made an impact on his life. The man that invited him to Marked Men is like a big brother to me. And he gave me away at our wedding.
Oh, my God.
Gave me away at our wedding. And because it had made such a profound effect on him, I kept saying to him, I wish that Marked Men had a sister organization. And it wasn't until later that I found out that they did. And I said, where do I sign up and when can I go? I am serious. Where do I sign up and when can I go? And I
so what year did he go?
He went to Tel High. in May of 2014.
Okay.
And I went to Malvern in June of 2015.
Wow. Yeah.
That's and when did you get married?
Yeah. We got married in September of 2014.
Wow.
Oh, okay.
That's awesome.
That's such a great story, Dee. I didn't know that.
That is so
cool. So Marked Man and Women's Walk have a very, very special place in my heart.
Yeah.
I love that. It's nice to know you have both have that same language. You can talk to each other and it builds your marriage, I think, and gives you those tools you need.
It does. Yeah. It does.
Yeah. Oh, that's a great story.
I tell sometimes, you know, they ask when women on the call team say, how did you get involved in the ministry? It's like, oh, you know, grab a chair, girlfriend. Here we go.
Get ready. Get your Kleenex box ready.
And you got to be ready when he answers your prayer, right? You're like, oh, all right.
Be careful what you pray for.
Yeah.
Yeah. Seriously, be careful what you pray for.
I think that's awesome.
That's really awesome.
And another thing about that is that how has Women's Walk changed my life? I grew up as an only child, and mm-hmm. I remember wanting sisters and mm-hmm. asking God for sisters. Mm-hmm. Be careful what you ask for.
Yeah. Do you have just a few now?
One or two. And the other thing is that he was wise enough to wait till I was old enough to appreciate it and say, you want sisters? Oh, girlfriend, just hang on to your hat. You know, it's going to be a ride.
Grab your bootstraps, Dee.
And go for it. And I have sisters that, and I honestly tell you that the women that I am closest to in this world, the majority of the women that I am closest to in this world are my Women's Walk sisters.
Mm. And you have sisters all across the country.
Do you- Even better.
It's a Even national better. Thing.
Absolutely. And the fun thing about it, I think what I enjoy more than anything else is when I go to staff in Colorado or North Carolina, or, you know, in Pennsylvania, I get to extend the hospitality.
Mm-hmm.
But when I go to staff in North Carolina, I get to hang out with women that I don't get to see that often. And I'm so excited that there's so many people coming in from Colorado for the Malvern weekend. I cannot wait. I need a sister infusion so badly.
Well, and this really is perfect timing because this episode will drop right before our Malvern weekend. So everyone will get to watch you before they go on the weekend because it'll drop on Thursday and the weekend starts on Friday.
Yes, ma'am. And I'll be at the airport Thursday picking up sisters.
Awesome.
Can't
so
wait.
You get to receive hospitality when you staff in other states and you get to give it when we come to PA.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
I love that. I'm so excited you guys are having a weekend and it's full. It's full missionary-wise.
And we're so excited.
Yeah, I can't wait.
Yeah.
It's going to be amazing.
Pennsylvania was the one weekend last year where we canceled in May of 2020. And then the Pennsylvania women said, we've got to reschedule. So let's reschedule for October. Like everyone was just so on fire. And then we had to cancel in October too. It was
we were all psyched for October.
Yeah.
We were totally psyched for October.
I was too. And then COVID reared its ugly head again.
But that's okay. We're getting back, right? We're getting back.
Yeah, not anymore.
No, we're not going to let that happen.
We're back on track.
Although it has had a huge benefit. I have been privileged to be able to work at home for the better part of a year. Mm-hmm. And I'm liking the 10-foot commute.
Yeah.
I'm really liking the 10-foot commute.
Nice.
It's a lot nicer than the 64-mile daily round trip.
Whoa.
Yeah, it's 32 miles one way to work for me.
Oh my gosh.
So I am hoping that if I beg and grovel politely enough with my boss, because I've already proven that I can work efficiently from home and get done everything that needs to be done, that he will let me work for the majority work from home.
Well, that'll be our prayer for you, our specific prayer.
That would be wonderful.
Okay.
And you're already an Enneagram too, so you can use that to your advantage.
Oh, trust me, I will, my dear. Completely.
You twos.
Okay. So what are some of the gifts that you get to use in women's walk?
Definitely the unconditional love.
Mm-hmm.
And a compassion. And, you know, as I say on my mission station, unconditional love, compassion, and a tender heart.
Mm-hmm.
I would agree. And I would
and just get to love on women and to, you know, because I, as I said, I've made some amazing connections. Mm-hmm. And not only women that have been in my spirit circle, but women that I was a wise woman to, or women after, you know, that I've gotten the opportunity to interact with over the weekend. Mm-hmm. And it's just been amazing. Just amazing.
That's awesome.
And it sounds like you're getting to use your gifts of hospitality as well this weekend.
Absolutely. Absolutely. One of the things that I have always enjoyed, and I think one of the reasons that I have no problems volunteering to go to the airport to pick sisters up, you know, especially when my Colorado sisters, is that not only it's selfish, but I get to spend that much more time with them.
Right, you get undivided time.
Does it get any better than that? I don't think so.
Yeah,
I don't think so. I get to love on them. I get to spend time with them, and just, you know, just stretch out the time, because the weekend always goes too fast.
Yeah,
and you don't think that Friday you sit down, you're getting ready for your meeting, and then all of a sudden it's Sunday. What?
It's I'm waking up Monday morning going, wait a minute.
Right.
I need three more days.
I need three more days. And I always take Monday afterwards off.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got to recuperate on Monday.
No, you got to regroup.
Yeah.
You know, just, you know, there's so much, you know, the combination of the emotions of everything that you go through and the seriousness of the weekend, but then also just the high of being with people that I love so dearly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you pour so much into it, you know, and you meet new people. And so you've had to make those connections. It's emotionally draining sometimes.
I think we all do. We all pour ourselves into the weekend because, you know, this ministry is so beautiful and it's so important to us that we want to give 100% of ourselves to Him.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and it's good for you as an introvert to recognize that, you know, you're with people and you're with the people and you're, you know, giving so much of your time that Monday is for you to just kind of regroup and just, you know, level up and get back
off more. And, you know, like, okay, I love you all, but I'm peopled out. I need some me time.
Yes, see, us extroverts, we can just go and go and go. People all the time.
You got to refill all those tears.
Oh, absolutely. I got to rehydrate.
Monday's rehydrating day.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I agree.
Absolutely.
Awesome. Well, I'm super excited about your weekend coming up. I'm really excited.
I'm super excited about my weekend coming up.
I can't wait.
Sleeping Thursday night's going to be hard.
Right?
Absolutely.
It's like Christmas.
Exactly.
We just did the weekend here for the first time in 15 months. You know, it was like, so like, it's your first staffing ever. You're like, ah, I don't even know what's gonna happen. Stop bread.
And you don't, and things look different than what they used to.
Mm-hmm.
But he shows up just like he used to.
Himself said to me, I'm of Irish descent, and I have always referred to my husband as himself because it's a very Irish thing. But himself said to me, you know, basically, you can staff anywhere on the East Coast, you know, because, you know, we get a little about the airfare to Colorado, but oh, you know, girlfriend, you can put me in a car and I can drive. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. On the East Coast, North Carolina's on the East Coast. Fair game.
Perfect.
If I can make it happen, it's going to happen.
It is a beautiful setting to staff in North Carolina.
It is gorgeous. It is gorgeous.
It'll be beautiful with the trees all in bloom.
Oh. And the mountains, and watching the sunrise over the mountains in the morning.
And that cross down on the hill down there, like in that valley.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
It is.
Magnificent.
Oh. Something to look forward to.
I can't wait.
So we will move into our buzz. We already talked about your wise woman, the most impactful thing that a wise woman has said to you. But as a reminder for all of those watching, our buzz is our funny fuel for Fridays. So this is just kind of the silly part of our show that we get to know you a little bit better on a funny level. And, you know, Kim and I love to laugh. So our first is, what is your favorite meal? It can be breakfast, lunch, or dinner, and it can be homemade or a restaurant.
I have learned to, and here's a good one for you. At the suggestion of, I started working with a personal trainer in January, and he is a dear friend of mine, also a retired police chief, who's a hoot and a half. Probably the biggest carnivore known to mankind, but his wife is a vegan.
Oh dear.
And they're a great combination. They really are. They're delightful people. But he suggested to me, because I was having some digestive issues, he suggested to me at one of our workouts, is that I want you to try an experiment. Go vegan for 2 days. And I looked at him like he had lost his mind. But he said, humor me. It made a difference.
Wow.
Really?
So I am primarily vegan now, which drives himself crazy, but that's a story for another day. But I have discovered that I really do enjoy cooking. And now that I am home most of the time and working from home, I have more time. You know, I don't waltz in the door after an hour commute and I go, oh my Lord, what am I going to put on the table for dinner? I have the time to experiment and do recipes. And I have just come up with a vegetarian/vegan chili that he raves about. So that's fun. You know, I enjoy going to do it. You know, something that he's going to say, this is good. You need to put this on the menu again. It's like, yes, success.
That's a win.
That's awesome. And it's making you feel better. So that's a win-win, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Huh. Good for you. Okay. So our next is your favorite or worst movie you have ever seen, or one of each.
Favorite movie, amazingly enough, he picks movies out, and sometimes I roll my eyes going, really? We're going to watch that? You know, and I'm not going to watch this movie. I really don't want to see it. I actually taught on Saturday and came home, you know, like comatose. He had dinner on the table, a movie on HBO, and I can honestly tell you it is probably one of the best movies I have ever seen, and I will watch it again and again and again because it was that impactful. The title of the movie is Something That the Lord Made, or Something the Lord Made. It's a 2004 movie. It stars, one of the stars is Alan Rickman, who for Harry Potter fans actually played Professor Snape.
Okay.
He is amazing. It's about a story about a doctor and his assistant who back in the 30s came up with the surgery. They perfected the surgery for blue babies, children that are born that the lungs don't work properly and they don't oxygenate properly. And so basically there's a blue tinge to their faces and their lips and what have you. And the gentleman that worked with him never went to medical school, but was just one of those innate you know, brilliant innate minds. And it was so controversial in that point in time because the doctor, Alan Blaylock, was white. And the gentleman that worked with him, somebody by the name of Vivian Thomas, was black. But they started out at Vanderbilt University in Tennessee and then went to Johns Hopkins. And eventually Vivian Thomas, actually awarded him, Johns Hopkins awarded him an honorary doctor's degree. And because he taught at it. I mean, the man, I get chills just thinking about it. The man was absolutely phenomenal and amazing. And I would watch the movie again. It is probably one of the most impactful movies I have ever seen.
Wow. Thank you. I've never heard of that before.
Did you cry?
I hadn't either. But it is an amazing movie.
Did you cry?
Absolutely. Oh, yes. Of course I did. Absolutely. Completely.
So it got the D cry of approval.
Oh, yes. 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 My seal of approval is if it makes me cry, it's a good movie. And it did.
I'll have to add that to my watch
list. Me too. I have to check that out. Thanks for the suggestion.
You are welcome.
So what's the most fun thing you've done during the pandemic besides your 10-foot commute?
I was just saying the 10-foot commute.
That's the fun thing?
Oh, absolutely, because it means that I am not getting up at hours that I'm not sure the good Lord means man to see with our eyes open. Like I was getting up at 3:15. To go to work. I mean, that, like I said, hours that I'm not sure that God means man to see with their eyes open.
Oh my God.
Seriously. But now I can get up 5:30, 6 o'clock and I go walk the treadmill and, you know, I'm sitting at my desk by 7 o'clock in the morning and I'm happy.
Wow. That's a good thing that came from it.
Oh, it's a great thing. It's a great thing. And I'm going to do my level best to try to keep it when I go back.
Yeah. Good.
I'm giving you the opportunity to get healthy. You said you've met with a personal trainer and now you're eating differently. And wow, big changes for you.
And he's a hoot and a half. I mean, this is somebody that we literally have been friends for 40 years.
Wow.
So a good guy who I know, who I trust. It's been fun what it has done for me. It's a great place to go and blow off steam as well. It's one of these places that I you know, when I walk in the door and he looks at me and he's, oh, it's been one of those days. Yeah, I guess it has, Andy, and we need to blow off lots of steam. I'll walk in the door and I'll say, oh, you are wound tighter than a drum. Yes, I am. Let's go work this out.
That's why I'm here.
Exactly.
That's good. I'm happy that you have that. That's exciting.
He's a good guy.
Yeah. Okay, so our last question is, if you didn't have to worry about making a living, what would your dream job be and why?
To write.
To write?
Mm-hmm. Why? To write, to finish the series that I started, of books that I started, and to edit and proofread just because I enjoy doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Like a series of romance books or what is it?
And what, come on, girlfriend, what do I know best? What did I do for 30 years?
Okay, so they're crime stories?
Of course they are.
Do they have a romantic twist?
Of course they do.
It'll make you cry?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Perfect.
Absolutely.
That would be wonderful.
I would read that.
I would read. Well, I don't.
I've written the first book. Now it's at some point in time I need to get it published.
Wow! Okay. Really? When did you write the first book?
2009.
Wow!
In 2 weeks.
Whoa!
I did. I wrote it in 2 weeks.
And it's fiction, but based on something you experienced.
It's fiction, but let me put it to you this way. The main character's name, she's a detective, and the main character's name is Dee Beiter. Does it sound even remotely reminiscent?
Christ.
Wow, that's exciting.
It was fun to write. It really was.
How long is it?
It's a full-fledged novel, and it leads into the characters are recurring characters, and it dovetails into the second book.
Wow.
And I started the second book, but I haven't progressed with it because I think what I need to do before I do that is retire full time so that I can sit and do nothing but write.
Or at least retire for 2 weeks. So you can write a book in 2 weeks.
Yeah. 2 weeks off and write the book. Yeah.
That's really cool.
Well, if you ever publish it, let me know. I'd love to read it.
I get
it. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I would love to have you read it.
That's exciting.
I like to read. Kim is not the biggest reader, but if it was something you wrote, I bet she would read it.
I would listen to it on an audiobook.
Yes, you'd have to record the audio version.
Yes. I'm just being honest. When I read, I sleep. Just does. I don't know why. A disconnect somewhere.
Audio books are a great way to pass time when you're going somewhere.
Yeah, but sometimes I've noticed I'll be like driving. I'm like, did I stop at that stop sign?
Not always a wise idea.
Right? Like I'm so enthralled. I'm like, I should probably stop doing that.
Well, Dee, we thank you so much for coming on the show. I really enjoyed getting to know you more and getting to hear how Women's Walk has impacted your life. And we just really appreciate you taking the time to come and talk to us.
Thank you for inviting me. It's been my pleasure. I am humbled and honored that I was asked.
We are very thankful that we got to know you just a little bit better, and we will be praying for you all as you prepare to staff next weekend. So.
Thank you.
This coming weekend.
This coming weekend.
This coming weekend.
I can't wait.
We will be praying for you. Thank you for sharing your stories with us.
Thank you.
Bless you, Dee.
Bless you.
Love you.
Love you.
Aw.
That was great.
Right? It's so nice to get to know different sisters in different states, because she's right. When we staff, it's so fast. Like, even if you get in on Thursdays, you don't get to really spend a lot of time with people. So I love being able to meet our sisters in other states. I think that's really cool.
And I loved her story about her husband and his experience in marked men and will you marry me? That's so cool. I've never heard that before.
We need to go on some marketing material or something.
Want to get married? Come to Women's Walk.
Who's in our marketing department? We need somebody.
That's such an amazing. I'm so glad that both ministries are a part of their story forever. You know, like that's awesome.
That is cool. That is awesome to have.
And even though she's an Enneagram 2, and we've had a lot of Enneagram 2s on the show, which again is great, she's a different kind of 2. Then she's a different kind of 2 than me. So I was interested to hear about her perspective that she could do her job and not really like feel the feels and be in her emotions and cry. Like I doubt she ever cried at work, you know, cause she put on the uniform and she was able to, you know, to be able to be who she needed to be at work and, you know, but still be a 2. She's still true to who she is, but be able to put on that shield. That's really interesting.
Yeah, I'm glad we got to dig into that a little bit with her, because we both said that when we said she was a 2, we were like, interesting. How does that play out? Because very different job and profession and how her life worked. And so I enjoyed hearing how she played that out. So
me too. Yeah. Me too.
It is good. And we do not only have 2s on our show, FYI people.
And I will just say, disclaimer, I'm not the one that selects the guests and makes them answer the Enneagram question. It is a very open process.
We listen to the Holy Spirit of our guests.
And it's not a coincidence. What was Dee's quote? That it's God's way of showing his miracles.
Yeah.
Anonymously.
That was beautiful. I loved that. That was cool. Yay! A new sister in PA.
Yes. So we will continue with our fuzz and move into our faithful fuel for Fridays.
Oh.
What verse do you got for us today?
So in honoring of the day that was just yesterday, which is Mother's Day, Margaret and I are going to do Proverbs 31. And I'm going to read verse 25 through 28. And I am reading it from the Today's English Version Bible. And it says, again, it's Proverbs 31, verse 25 through 28, says, "She is strong and respected and not afraid of the future. She speaks with gentle wisdom. She is always busy and looks after her family's needs. Her children show their appreciation and her husband praises her."
So mine is out of the NIV version, and it says, "She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, as he praises her."
I love that. That's a beautiful verse. And we really suggest you read the whole Proverbs 31. It's beautiful, especially since the majority of our viewers are women. It has some beautiful words. And like I say, my verse is entirely different than Margaret's, but really the same message, but just a little bit different wording and how it says it. And it's so honoring to who we are as women and what our purpose is in this life, I think, is kind of what you can see from it and how he created us and what he expected from us. And yeah, it's beautiful.
And even if you aren't a mother, or, you know, sometimes Mother's Day can be a hard day for some people, but this verse, I think, speaks to how we can mother others. Even if there's no one that actually calls us mother, we can be loving and nurturing and have dignity and nurturing to others around us, the people in our lives. And it's, you know, it's still just, you know, it's impactful and it's a way to live a godly life, speaking wisdom and, having those around you be, you know, show that you have honor and that you are a blessing to others and have people recognize that. And so it's not just for mothers, it's for women of all kinds.
It is. And it doesn't have to be your husband praising you. It can be God praising you, the Lord himself praising you. And like we always talk about, your gifts in your right and your weaknesses in your left. What are those right hands that he gives you? And those are his praises for you. And so it doesn't always just have to be a mother, but definitely just reflecting on yesterday is why we kind of chose that. But also because we are a women's ministry. That's who we are.
Yeah.
So we want all women to feel that and feel appreciated. So we hope that you do take the time to read that verse yourself and just dive into it and see what part of it speaks to you.
And I haven't even looked it up on the Message version to see what that says. I'm sure that's excellent too.
It's beautiful.
As it usually is. So I'll have to look that up.
Yeah. So do take the time and look it up. Because it's very, they have beautiful words in there. We couldn't share it all because it's kind of. And so that'll take us into our G-wogging, God on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure that everybody will have stories about their moms for yesterday's kind of what we were thinking about for today. And so I found this beautiful poem and it really spoke to me about not only for myself as being a mom, but also my own mother and how her reflection and what she did for my life. And so it says, "A mother's love is something that no one can explain. It is made of deep devotion and of sacrifice and pain. It is endless and unselfish and enduring come what may, for nothing can destroy it or ever take it away. It is patient and forgiving with all when all others are forsaking, and it never fails or falters, even though the heart is breaking. It believes beyond believing when the world around condemns, and it glows with all the beauty of the rarest and brightest gems. It is far beyond defining, and it defies all explanation, and it still remains a secret like the mysteries of creation. A many splendorous miracle man cannot understand, and another wondrous evidence of God's gentle guiding hand."
That's so good.
It's so good. It's so, just makes you think of the sacrifices, you know, that your own mother had to make for you, or the sacrifices that you make as a mother. And it never ends. You know, even when we think they're 18 and we're done, it doesn't end. It's a constant journey and a constant path for us as wives and mothers. And sometimes it's hard. Sometimes it's really, really hard to be the mom and to watch your kids suffer. But you get to be there and see the good parts too. And so that's what makes it all worthwhile for me. So do you have a moment with your mom that you want to share, Margaret? Or?
I'm celebrating with my mother on Friday. We're going out to a fancy restaurant. But I did get to FaceTime with her yesterday. And I love it when my mom... she laughs so hard, she cries. And we had one of those moments on FaceTime yesterday that I was there. I had tears dripping down my eyes because we were just laughing so hard at something my dad did. And it was just like, I love those moments with her. And so God gave me one of those moments yesterday, even though I wasn't with her. We were on FaceTime and we had a really good belly cry laugh, belly ache and cry and laugh. So that was really special.
That's awesome. And was it 2 years ago you and her went on a trip together? Just you?
Yes. In 2019, we got to do a special mother-daughter trip to Estes Park. We both love Estes Park, Colorado. And so just me and her went up for the whole weekend and we went bowling and we went out to dinner and she taught me how to sew these little stockings for Christmas that I gave away to my neighbors. And she's very crafty. So she taught me all kinds of things about how to stitch and to sew on buttons and to glue. And she's got it all. So we had a really great time and we decided to make it annual and then COVID, but we are going to do it in the fall this year. We're going to be back on track. So it's going to be an annual thing.
That's awesome. I love that.
Yeah. Did you have any special God moments yesterday?
So for me, I would say my God moments with my mom, not just yesterday, but some of you know, my mom and I did our weekend together in Women's Walk. We did our bridge together in Women's Walk, and we were actually in Circle together just up until recently. And just being able to share that with her and to watch how she supported me and I was able to support her. It was beautiful to always see God just intervening in our lives and all the time. And now my mom and I both do the Lecticio app every morning and we each share. Once we finish, we share whatever we got out of it with each other. And so I'm really blessed to be able to share that with her. And then she was very instrumental in helping my husband give me a beautiful birthday party, surprise birthday party on Saturday. And so I always get to see, and I get that gift from my mom of hospitality and welcoming people. And she just does a phenomenal job. She is unconditional with her love for everybody and would do anything for anybody. And I am blessed and thankful to be one of those many people that she just showers with her unconditional love all the time. And so I get to watch it because she's my neighbor too. So I get to watch it a lot, but I'm very blessed to have her. And she's given me a lot of guidance and wisdom in my life. And she's always praying for me. And I know that. And I've learned to do that for my own children, to just always pray for them just by watching her and knowing that I've been saved a lot by her prayers. That's for sure. So I enjoy those times and I can't wait to see what the future has for us too.
Oh, we love your mama.
She's a good lady.
She's a good one. You hit the mama jackpot with her.
I think we both did.
Yes, I did too. Yes. A lot more people know your mom than my mom.
That is true. A lot of people are like, that's your mom? That's my mom.
That's my mom. I'll claim her.
It is. I was sad that she checked out a Circle, but I understand. It was being on Zoom is hard for some people, and so I get that. So I honor where she's at with that. And we just share different things now. So that's okay.
But both of our moms are viewers of the show. So happy Mother's Day, moms. Yes.
And thank you for loving us who we are and creating us who we are.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I was going to also mention that May is your birthday month and that now you are the resident wise woman of the show because you have crossed over into the wise woman realm. So
happy I crossed birthday. Over the hill. I'm on top at 50. Thank you.
I know that you had a very special birthday, but it's your birthday month, so you get to celebrate all month long.
I keep telling Glenn that he's not quite on board.
I'll call him. I'll let him know.
Just tell him every day.
Well, and I've told you this already, but you were wise before, even last week, you know, 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago when we did the show, you were still our resident wise woman. But now it's official because you're in the 50s. So you're our official wise woman. Oh. Or speaking life. No pressure.
Yikes. Maybe she needs a new co-host.
No.
Well, thank you, Mark. And thank you for sharing my day with me. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed having you here.
Absolutely. So we thank you all so much for watching, and we hope that you enjoyed our conversation with Dee. And if you are staffing the Pennsylvania weekend, we can't wait to hear all about it and hear your GWalking moments. So send them over to us. My email address is margaret@womenswalkwithchrist.org, and Kim's is kim@womenswalkwithchrist.org. And we'd love to hear about your God sightings and how God, you saw God on the ground, because we know that's coming up this weekend. So even if you're not staffing, if you have a God moment you want us to share on the show, we'd love to share it and we'd love to hear it. And again, we just thank you so much for taking the time to watch the show. And yeah, we'll see you next time.
Yes. And also, if you have a story you want to share about your mom, share your story about your mom. Yes, we'd love to hear about your mom too and how she's blessed your life. So
yeah, post it in the comments or send it our way and we can talk about it.
Yeah. So thank you again for watching. We hope you all have a blessed couple of weeks, and we'll see you in 2 weeks.
Bless you.
Bless you.